One of the messages was, well, he will, a couple of months ago, he woke me, right this morning, he said to me, Mommy, Jesus spoke to me last night about his word and he's coming again. And these letters is on the website, you can see it there, which is going to be very, very, very soon. Do you know that, Mommy? And then he would tell about the bride. Jesus wants to come and fetch his bride, but his bride is not ready.
Tell me about, because this is amazing, when he was weeping one day about the golden bridge.
Yes. He can't cry like he normally cries. So he would just make noises. And he was laying his head on his arms and crying. And I said, why are you crying? He says, in heaven there's a golden bridge. And after the bridge there's a huge door with pearls around it. He says, but there's people standing outside and they're crying. I said, why are they crying? He says, they can't go in. And I said, into what? He looked at me and said, don't tell me you don't know. I said, no, I'm not sure. He says, there's a wedding feast inside and everybody's not ready. So every day he will journal a whole page. That next morning, he only did this. He wrote Matthew 25 and he left for school.
And he shouldn't have not, he should have not even known what was in Matthew 25.
Well, I didn't.
So what did you, read it immediately?
Yes, I ran to my Bible and I read it, and it was about the 10 virgins.
Five wise, five foolish.
Five is wise and five foolish. Five is ready and five is not. And I tell you, this is the bride today. We're all in church. But Jesus did not come to give us religion. He came for an intimate, passionate love relationship with a king.
Jesus assured me after we arrived in heaven during the early hours of February 29th.
The only ones who can come here are the ones whose hearts are as pure as the water. Many people think I will never come for them, but I tell you, I am coming sooner than they think.
When he said this, the tone of his voice changed. He seemed to be almost angry, or at least I sensed a great urgency in his words. It was a warning. It was a message I had to share, and share now. The end times are truly upon us. Jesus is coming soon. He went on to remind me,
I am telling you all this and showing you these things so you can tell the world.
Then he reiterated the importance of all these experiences by saying,
I know that a lot of my children don't think I will come back for them for a long time. Some even think I will never come back for them, but I want you to tell them that my kingdom is ready for those who are ready and waiting for me. I am coming very soon.
Lord, will all the Christians go with you when you come for us?
I am going to show you something, the Lord answered instantly. I want you to remember all that you see. I want the whole world to know what is going to happen soon. I know many Christians do not believe what my prophets are telling them. That is why I am showing this to you.
The air was filled with white moving objects. As the vision clarified, I saw people wearing white robes flying through the air. People were popping out of the earth everywhere and flying up into the air. The sky was literally filled with flying people, like birds in migration. I had heard the rapture described before, but I had never imagined what an amazing spectacle it would be. I wondered what those who do not know Jesus would think when they observe such a scene. I was shocked and excited, but I'm sure they will be terrified. This was the biggest surprise the Lord had ever shown me. It was the most awe-inspiring thing I'd ever seen human beings flying through the air like birds. They soared upward with rocket-like speed. Some seemed to be soaring like kites in the wind on a clear, beautiful day. I saw my one-year-old granddaughter. She was wearing a white robe, and her hair had grown to shoulder length. She looked pretty grown up. At first, I saw her at her house in normal clothing. Then, suddenly, she was wearing a white robe and flying through the air. I was dumbfounded by the vision. It certainly seemed to confirm that the Lord would be returning in the very near future. Then I saw my daughter's 10-month-old daughter. She does not have much hair right now, but in the vision her hair was down to her shoulders, and like my other granddaughter, she was flying through the air. I felt the Lord had a good reason for showing the children to me. First, I'm sure He wanted me to know that they will be with God in heaven to enjoy all eternity with Jesus. Second, I knew He wanted me to see how old they would be when He returns. It is sooner than most people think. The joyous vision changed. I saw the people who did not ascend with the others. Places on earth had been disrupted. Some had been turned upside down. It was noisy everywhere, and people were in an obvious state of panic. Terror was written on every face. People were running wildly. Total pandemonium reigned. It seemed as if each person was searching for someone or something that they could not find. I began to cry like a little child as I watched people running down the streets. They were screaming and yelling. Some were trying to throw what few belongings they possessed into vehicles such as cars and boats. Thousands of boats were on the ocean. People were trying to escape. Many men in uniforms were storming houses, ransacking them and taking the belongings they found. I noticed one family of four or five lying on the floor of a house. Most of them were on their stomach, and a pool of blood covered the floor. Hundreds of people were fleeing on foot to the mountains. As they did, the uniformed guards fired guns at them, and several fell. Those nearest the guards were beaten with clubs and sticks. I saw people destroying churches. A man threw a rock at a beautiful stained glass window that showed Jesus with his lambs. The window shattered and glass flew in all directions. I screamed more loudly. One woman who appeared to be looking for a lost child was running through her house, shouting in panic and fear. She kept calling her child's name as she jumped up and down in total frustration and desperation. I wanted to help her, but there was nothing I could do. I cried and cried for her and for all the others. Then I saw a family I know personally. The father ran into his house and rushed from room to room, calling the names of his wife and children. He found one member of his family, and they sat huddled in a corner of a room. I know who they are, but I am not at liberty to mention their names in this book. The vision eventually vanished, and I continued to cry. The Lord wiped my tears.
"Daughter," He said, "I must show you these things so you can tell the whole world what is going to happen. I love all my children, and I want them to realize I am coming for them soon. But I cannot bring those who don't live according to my word, because they are not ready for me. Many Christians will be surprised when the end times come. What you just saw is only a small part of what will happen very soon. It will be much worse than you can possibly imagine for those who do not know me. That is why I want all my children to be able to come with me to my kingdom. Daughter, I have shown you part of the kingdom and the things that are going to happen in this world because the time is short. I will return soon. You have seen what is going to happen on earth in the very near future. I am ready for my children, but so many of my children do not really believe, and they are living for worldly things. I love all of them and want to bring all of them to heaven with me, but I cannot take those who are not ready for me. Those who come to my kingdom must be pure-hearted and obedient. My coming for my people is so near. I try to save as many souls as I can, no matter what it takes. Satan knows this, and he is trying to destroy as many souls as he can before they are saved. People should realize why so many people are dying now. every church must cast out the devil continually by prayer. My churches have been too comfortable. I am very dissatisfied with many of them. I want the whole world to know that I am a fearsome God. I love my children, and that is why I died for them. I must be first in everyone's life. Everyone needs to repent and be humble before me. There will be a great distraction in this world continually until I come for my people. That day is sooner than they expect.
David was not a believer in the Messiah. David did not know the Bible, but one night when you were 17,
yes, sir,
you had a vision, and it's so interesting to me. This was not just one vision. He then had a second one of the same thing after he became a believer in the Messiah. It's as if God knew David's purpose before David knew God. Tell me what happened.
Well, my sister asked me to babysit her children while she wanted to go skating, and I did, and I put the kids to bed. And I had a portable radio, and I was trying to turn it on to try to get a station. All of a sudden, I heard a woman scream. And it's not like it was behind the house or in front of the house. It was just like in the air. So as I went to go towards the window, I stopped it. I said, no, wait. If I go towards that window, I'm going to see something that I don't want to see. But see it, I was compelled to go. And so I pulled back the curtains. It was on the second story, and I looked down, and I didn't see anything. I was like, there's nothing wrong. And then when my eyes caught the stars in the heavens, all of a sudden, I'm just like a big movie screen, and color, the moon appeared. And it's like someone took an ice pick and poked the moon. Then blood began to ooze out of the moon. And then all the stars in the heaven began to fall all at once. And then the sky itself began to roll up as a scroll. And it was happening simultaneously. The moon turned to blood. The stars fall from the heaven. The sky roll up as a scroll. And all of a sudden, I seen a woman with long black hair. She was beholding what was happening, coming upon the earth. And she began to take her fingernails and dig in her face and scream and holler. Then I seen hundreds of people running, thousands of people running, and the horror on their faces. And what God allowed me to sense what they were feeling, total helplessness. Total terror. And all of a sudden the vision disappeared and I fell to the ground and I was trembling and shaking. I was like, oh my God, what did I see? Sid, I didn't know anything about visions at the time. And I was like, what should I do? I said, maybe I get the Bible. And I was walking through the house. I said, please, Lord, don't let me see nothing else. Please don't. I thought something was going to come again. I said, please. And I got the Bible and I just opened it up and I went to Revelation, the 6th chapter, beginning at the 12th verse. And it began to tell about the day of the Lord and the moon turning to blood. And I was like, oh God, I began to look at that. And I said, Lord Jesus, look what's happened. I seen this with my eyes. And all of a sudden I called my Uncle Eddie. He was a preacher. And I told him what happened. He said, son, God just showed you a vision. I said, you mean to tell me I'm not going crazy? He said, no, you're not going crazy. He said, God gave you an open vision. When you're going to say yes to Jesus? When you're going to serve the Lord? He's called you to be a preacher of the gospel. And I said, oh, I don't know if I can live saved. I don't know if I can do it. And from that day, I knew within myself, there's something I must do for God.
But I am going to take you to February 2012. What happened to you?
Well, I got up to go use the restroom, and as I was coming back and I was getting back in the bed, it's like someone grabbed me by the arm and shook me. Next thing I know, I'm catapulted into an open vision, and I'm hovering about 200 feet over the earth, and I can see all the beautiful skies and the sun and all the happiness, people going to and fro in the land, mothers with their children going into the grocery stores, people pumping gas, businessmen with their ties and briefcases going into the buildings. Then all of a sudden, a thick darkness and clouds started appearing upon the earth. And then, all of a sudden, there was a sound from heaven, a sound that I have never heard before in all my born days. It was like seven claps of thunder, uttered into one. The sound was so deafening, not only did it pierce pierce the ears of all mankind, but it began to pierce their skeleton, that when they heard it, their bodies began to shake and quake. And this sound was so deafening, people began to scream. Then all of a sudden, like someone took a razor blade and split the heavens, then here come the Son of God with all his bands of angels and all his glory. Oh, see it, and the colors were glorious, splendid, magnificent, glorious, the blues, the golds, the greens. I never seen such colors like this. And he was coming speedily on the earth. Then people began to urinate on themselves and scream. And then one man said, no, wait. I thought I had time. But too late. All time it ran out for all mankind. Another man, he was like an Indian guy, real short. He began to say, no, this is a dream. I'm gonna wake up. But see it, he couldn't wake up because he was already woke. Then I heard a voice from heaven saying, "This is the day of the Lord. It has come." And I came out of the vision, trembling on the floor, and I'm shaking and quaking within myself. And I begin to pray for me. I didn't pray for my mother, my wife, my children. I begin to intercede for me because God allowed me to see such terror. Terror, we know God is love and he's mercy and he's long-suffering and he's gentle and he's kind. But see, there's another part of God that mankind has not been introduced to, and that's the terror of the Lord. Such terror, such horror. And I begin to repent over my own life. Lord, save me. God, forgive me. Because he allowed me to sense what everyone was feeling, and I begin to repent because I say, God, I want to be pleasing to you, Lord. If I have hurt you or come against you in any shape, form, or another, please forgive me, Lord. Lord, please allow me to be counted worthy to go back with you. I have seen the day of the Lord. Then the Lord spoke to me, say, I charge you now to warn all mankind. And he said it like this, I'm coming. Whether they will believe you or not, give them warning from you. Whether they receive you or not, give them warning from you, for the day of the Lord is at hand.
God is telling many people, from even that are not believers in the Messiah, the same thing. For instance, Orthodox Jews in Israel are being told that we are in the footsteps of the coming of the Messiah. In other words, they know something is up in the air. About the same time that David had that dream, I had a dream. And in my dream, I wasn't even thinking about this. It didn't cross my radar. If someone had said to me, the Lord is coming back soon, I would have said, yes, I believe that. But, you know, I'm 73. In my heart of hearts, I'm not sure I really believe that. You're supposed to say he's coming back soon. You're supposed to live like he's coming back soon. But there just seems to be so much that has to be done. But it's not up to my peanut brain. It's up to God. And this is what God showed me in the dream. He said to me three times, I'm coming back soon. I'm coming back soon. I'm coming back soon. David, between you and me, what did you believe in your heart about the Lord's return? I mean, between the two of us.
Well, I didn't think it was close. I mean, according to all the scriptures and the Revelation teachers and the scholars, I knew it was going to come, but I wasn't sure. But now I'm absolutely sure that he's coming at an hour and at a time when man least expected.
What should someone do that's just heard this message and believes it's from God?
Set their house in order. Whatever they need to do for God, they must do quickly. If they need to ask for forgiveness, they better do it quickly. If they need to go to their mother, father, sister, brother, ask for forgiveness, they need to go get things straight before it's everlasting too late. Because the terror of the Lord is like something I've never seen in my entire life.
Okay, let me take you. I know you're living a holy life. Mm-hmm. I know that you love God. Right after that open vision, what did you do?
I began to repent and cry out to God.
But you repented. I know you. You repented way before a vision like that.
Not like this one. not like this one, because he made it so real to me. It was so real, and it was so overpowering and overtaking that men and women could not even think straight when it happened. And he came so suddenly, just like he said he would.
Why is there so much urgency in you giving this message? I mean, I've never seen someone with such a compulsion, like in an urgency in your voice. Why?
Because there's an unction within inside of me that I don't have much time. You don't have much time. We don't have much time. And I must preach it. And I must proclaim it just as Noah did for 120 years that it was going to rain. But they turned a deaf ear to Noah. They didn't believe that man of God. But the Bible say, God said unto Noah, come you and your family into the ark. For he opened up the windows of heaven, and the windows of heaven poured out the water upon the land, and everything that breathed through nostrils died, just like God said he would.
Angelica Zambrano visited to heaven for 23 hours. At the time of coming back, she saw a vision of the rapture. Many Christians were left behind. Jesus told her many times that he is coming for the holy people. It is time to repent our sins daily. Turn away from sins. Love Jesus with all your heart.
We walked to a place with a giant screen, and I saw people in it. I could observe the whole world. Then suddenly I saw thousands of people disappearing. Pregnant women had their pregnancy disappear, and they looked like they had gone crazy screaming. Children had disappeared from all over. Many people were running from here to there, screaming, "This can't be, this can't be. What's happening?" I saw those who had known the Lord, but were left behind. They were saying that Christ had come, the rapture happened. They screamed and wanted to kill themselves, but they couldn't. The Lord told me,
"Daughter, in those days, death will flee. Daughter, in those days the Holy Spirit will no longer be on earth."
There were accidents, but I didn't see a single dead person. All of them were alive, although injured. After the rapture, observed enormous traffic with thousands of people. He told me,
"Daughter, look, this is how everything will happen."
I then saw people running from one place to another, shouting, "Christ came. Christ came." They would plead, "Lord, forgive me, take me with you." But sadly the Lord said,
"It will be too late. The time to repent is now. Daughter, go tell humanity to seek me, for during that time there will no longer be opportunity. Daughter, it will be too late for all those that stay behind."
When Jesus observed how people were left behind, he began to weep and said,
"Daughter, I will go to earth as it says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16 and 17, for the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord."
But not everyone will go with the Lord. Only those who are doing his will and living a holy life. For the Lord told me,
"Only those that are holy will enter the kingdom of heaven. No one knows, neither the day nor the hour in which I will go for my holy people, not even the angels know it."
On the screen I saw people running around. Magazines and TV news said that Christ had come. The screen closed, and Jesus finished by saying,
"I will go for the holy people."
This was all he showed me.
"Many will not believe you, many will believe you, but I am your faithful witness. I am with you. I will never leave you."
The Lord told me,
"Daughter, in those days the Holy Spirit will no longer be on earth. In those days, he will no longer be on earth."
And I saw enormous traffic, with accidents. Many people wanted to kill themselves, but Jesus said,
"They shall seek death, but death shall flee from humanity. Death will no longer be during that time."
I saw people watching TV and magazines that read, "Thousands and thousands have disappeared." Many already knew that Christ had come for his holy people. Those who knew the Lord, but were left behind, went crying through the streets, wanting to kill themselves, but they could not do anything. While in heaven, Jesus said,
"I will come for a holy people and I will come soon for my church."
But recently, the Lord told me,
"Daughter, I take pleasure in what you are doing, that you are fulfilling what I have given you, but do not tell my people that I am coming soon. Tell my people that I am coming right away.
Again the Lord said,
tell my people that I am coming right away and that I am coming for the holy people. Tell my people that only the holy ones will see me. And do not be silent. Keep on declaring what I have told you.
Angelica will now testify her experience. This is when angels took her to a heavenly viewpoint and showed her the current condition of the church.
From a heavenly viewpoint, an angel said,
look, you are seeing the earth. Look at the churches and congregations of the earth. This church has 20,000 members. There is another church with 10,000 members. This other church has 1,000. But there are very few people in these churches that are actually the true church. Are you seeing?
Yes, I answered. The angel said,
I must tell you what my father wants me to tell you.
The archangel Michael was the one speaking to me. Michael said,
look at the earth. The churches are filled with sin. There is very much sin in the churches. Many of the people are spiritually dead.
I was shown that 80% of the evangelical Christian church on earth will be left behind. My God, they will be left behind because they are cold. Because they don't seek God's presence. Because of their sin. Because they are discouraged. Only 20% will be caught up to be with Jesus. This is only for true Christians. This is why his word says, many are called, but few are chosen in Matthew 22. We were all called, but we not only must be called, we must also be chosen. Let me explain what takes place inside many of the churches. There is very much religion. There is no loyalty to the word of God. Inside church, brothers and sisters happily praise the Lord. They rejoice, they dance, and they speak in tongues. But when they get home they are completely different. They act like the devil himself. This is what takes place. People go home and speak things that hurt God's heart. At home you don't pray, read God's word or seek his presence. God does not want any of us to be left behind. It hurts me that 80% of church congregants are not ready for the Lord's return. Do you know why? Because few of the churches truly demonstrate the true love of Jesus. There were angels around when Jesus spoke to me. The angels were silent. The Lord said,
daughter, my heart breaks to see how many people are discouraged, to see how many people have backslid. Tell my people to return to ancient paths, to the first love.
All of us have been seeking God diligently during this 21-day fast. After this we can't look back at the past. We must press forward. The Lord promised us in his word, he will be with us. Don't worry about the trials to come in the future. You can't imagine the trials I have endured. Actually, all of us endured together. Although I don't know your trial, it doesn't really matter. We must press forward because only the courageous will enter in his presence. When you return to your congregations, you must encourage the brethren. We are one family in Christ. You must encourage them to seek God. Tell them to seek God. Reject hypocrisy. Listen to what the Lord told me. He said,
do you know which commandment my church has forgotten? Someone think it is love. Others think it's faith. The forgotten commandment within the church is holiness. My word says, be holy for I am holy.
This is what the Lord said. We have to be holy inside and outside. We must have a pure heart, a clean heart that is filled with his presence, a heart filled with his love, a heart filled with God.
What I have revealed to you, you must speak. It's necessary. It's necessary, so the pastors will return to me. So the pastors won't condemn their congregations, because the churches will be in the condition of their pastors. This is why I allowed this. I will do great things. My daughter, don't fail me. Everything I have revealed to you, you must speak. You must tell the world of everything I have shown you, the whole world, because you will go to nations. You will go to nations preaching of what I have shown you. It's necessary. It is I who speaks, believe my servant. She is the daughter of my eyes. With the humility she has, I will use her. I took her so she could see the message I have for the churches. This message is for pastors. Churches will follow their pastor's example. There are many churches, but few are chosen.
On the 2nd of August, the visit was from 9:15 to 10:12. And as usual, the Lord came to me and said, Sarah, I must speak with you. He took my hand and we flew to heaven. And once changed, the Lord told me he needed to show me something. He led me to a huge TV again, and we sat down, and I sensed that the Lord had gone back to his godliness as God. And in the TV, there was chaos. People were running, everyone screaming. And that it was some people were even trying to hide, but it was impossible. You could not hide from that. It's just a big no, because everywhere you tried to hide the Lord, it was all open to the Lord. And I heard the Lord say to me, he said, this daughter is judgment day, the day I will return for my children. I will come like a thief. Nobody knows the date, day, minute, or second. Tell my children to repent and come back to me so that they can enjoy the city that I built for them. For I, the Lord, is coming back soon. It's coming back very soon, sooner than you all think. And when the Lord says this, he is warning us. The Father, our Father himself, is warning us. Like, you've read it in the Bible, but he is warning us. Like, he's telling us that I am coming soon. You don't. No one knows the day the Lord is coming back. No one knows the date, time, or day, or even year he's coming back. But when the words that you must concentrate very clearly on the words that the Lord say. He said, I'm coming back very soon, sooner than you all think. And when he said this, I kind of got frightened myself, because I was like, this could mean he could come back tomorrow. He could come back the day after. And take this as an urgent message to children of God out there. Please, please, please. If it's now that if you're watching me right now, this moment, just take a minute. Just pause, stop everything you're doing. Just take a minute to just repent. Because you don't know the time God's coming back. He could come back any minute from them. He could come back within the next 5 minutes. And if he catches you out of God, and that you haven't been able to repent, you're going to end up in hell for something so small, so tiny. So just take time to repent. Just please, 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 just repent your heart. Please, just I'm begging you, repent your heart so that you are able to end up in heaven on the last day.
You move in prophecy. Has God told you things about what will be happening shortly in the United States or Israel that you can share?
Well, I know that Israel, the Lord has been speaking to me, is going to have one of the greatest moves of God they've ever had. Because God is going to answer prayer. The Jew and Gentile are going to come together like you spoke about in your book.
Ezekiel 47 talks about a double river. And when the two come together, there's life that goes wherever that double river goes. And the double river is the Jew and Gentile, one new man, one in Messiah.
And Sid, it talks about in the book of Ezekiel that every person will be healed. God is going to answer prayer. There's going to be a great move of God in Jerusalem. There's going to be a lot of disasters in a lot of cities and areas, like I mentioned to you the other day, California and different ones. But at the same time, it will be like when Azusa Street was poured out in California. They had the worst earthquake they have ever had up in San Francisco. So I wish it didn't take tragedy to bring people to the Lord, but this harvest has got to come in, Sid, as well as you know. The Jew and the Gentiles have got to meet together. All denominations have got to come together for this harvest to come in, and the Lord says it's going to come before he comes back. So the disaster will bring the greatest harvest we've ever had. Believe God and walk with God, and remember, there is a day that he's going to split those clouds and come back, and God wants you to be ready.
Do you think did he tell you whether it would be in your lifetime, or you don't know?
Well, I don't know, but he just told me to work quickly. He walked in my room a few months back and said, work quickly, Loretta, because I will come soon.
Every day, I hear the audible voice of God in some manner. Every day, I get to see the angels of God, and I have seen Jesus on numerous occasions. In revival meetings, the angels are visible to me. The cloud of glory is visible to me. The sickness and diseases in people's bodies are visible to me. The demons that afflict them are visible to me. The glory that comes upon them when God heals them is also visible to me. God has truly poured out upon me a prophetic ministry of signs and wonders and miracles. And I am to tell the story that Jesus is coming soon. He told me before he sent me back that I would come back, and when I did, I had to tell his people to get ready. These are the words of the Lord. He said, "Prepare yourselves and get ready, because I am coming back soon at a time when people don't think I'm coming back. I am coming back. He is coming after his sons and his daughters, and he is coming after his servants. He is coming after all of us that we might go with him to that place called heaven. Are you ready? Are you really ready?"
On May 8th, 2005, he's minding his own business, sleeping. What happened?
And then all of a sudden, in the middle of the night, my spirit begins to rise up out of my body. And at first, I was just like hovering, hanging over the bed. I could see my physical body laying there. I could see my wife laying next to me. And I thought to myself, what in the world is going on? I thought I had passed away. That thought went through my mind. Then all
I could understand.
Yeah. And then all of a sudden, I feel these two massive arms, and I knew it was an angel. And I could see myself. He was cradling me, holding me in between his two arms. And the moment I saw that, we began to rise. And I remember looking at the roof, and I ducked my head because I thought I was going to hit my head against the roof. And to my surprise, we go right through the roof of the house. And so that's when I thought, oh, Lord, I passed away. And I began to pray for my wife, my kids. So for a brief moment, my mind and my thoughts, my emotions were on earthly matters. And then all of a sudden, from one instant to another instant, in a moment, my emotions were flooded with this incredible joy. Joy I had never felt before, because I knew that I was about to go see Jesus, the Son of God. And so I remember just closing my eyes and thinking to myself, I'm ready. And then we shoot through the atmosphere, going through the clouds. And then in an instant, I find myself in this big open expanse of a place. So for lack of a better word, a large opening, a room. I didn't see any buildings. I didn't see any angels. I didn't see anybody. I just saw in the natural, I'm colorblind. So I saw these incredible colors, massive, beautiful colors. And the unique thing about that, Sid, was the colors were actually breathing. There was life. Like if it was lungs, it was expanding and, you know, inhaling, and I could see the colors actually breathe and full of life.
You know, I have heard reports like this before. Everything is alive in heaven. I have heard that the grass is even alive. It's like we haven't even experienced life on this dead earth until we have the life of God inside of us. But how would you like to be in a place where everything is alive? No death! I like it.
Yes. And so from that room, all of a sudden, in an instant, I was back into this other room. And in this room, I saw two figures. And they were standing at an angle like this. I was maybe from here to the camera, maybe 10 feet. And then I heard a voice. And the voice said, "To you, it's been granted to stand here and listen." Because I immediately recognized it was the Father and the Son. At first, I didn't know who that was. But as I got a little closer, then I heard the voice. I recognized it was Jesus and the Father. And they were having a conversation. And so when I heard the voice that told me, "You've been granted permission to stand here and listen," I remember turning my ear this way to listen to their conversation. And to my surprise, they were talking about the end times. I remember hearing clearly that they talked about the difficult hour that lay ahead, and how the church would be given the opportunity to be purged and the opportunity to really experience the greatness of what still lays ahead, the greatest outpouring of the Spirit of God. But clearly, the way the download that I was receiving as I heard all that reminded me very much of this, the readings that that you do on an annual basis as a regular Christian on the end times, the book of Revelation, the book of Daniel. So I remember listening to this conversation, and I was brought to my memory was all the judgments that are coming based upon the book of Revelation and also Joel, the book of Daniel. And but I received, and I felt like this is an hour, an opportunity for the church to be stronger and to understand the importance to be ready and alert, because my sense is, for the most part, the body of Christ, for the most part, is not prepared for what is about to take place.
Okay. Do you think you'll be alive when all this happens?
I firmly believe that I will be alive. I believe that my eyes will physically see the coming of the Lord. And when you study church history, those who remained on fire for the Lord, even the Apostle Paul and Peter, they believed in their day, in their hour, that they would see the coming of the Messiah, the coming of the Lord. And I feel like the church must understand once again end time eschatology. We must be students. We must understand the signs, the seasons, the hour that we're living in so that we can live an urgent life. And when we have that understanding of sense of urgency, our hearts, our lives are completely given to the Lord. I feel like there's a greater surrender as a result of understanding the hour that we're living in.
Okay. But then the most terrifying thing that ever happened to Carlos happened to him in heaven. What happened?
Well, what happened was they went from discussing about the urgency of the hour, they went to discussing about the greatest outpouring of the Holy Spirit, greatest miracles, not all gloom and doom. There's great hope. But then the hope culminates in this incredible manifestation that I believe the Spirit of God is doing right now, and that is this. I heard the Father say to Jesus, "It's time, son. Go get your bride."
What did that mean to you?
At first, I was shocked and stunned, but I had this download and understanding of revelation that I, as part of the Church of Christ, in that moment, I was not prepared, and I was not ready to really see him come back. Even though we may have the right confession, we may have the right lingo, we may say the right words, but in reality, for the most part, many of us in the church, including myself at that time, I was not ready, was not prepared. And so when those words came out of the Father to the Son, I remember this, it was the most horrible fear. I call it the terror of the Lord. The most horrible fear and terror that I had ever felt. It was like those words rolled out of his mouth like a ball of fire. And I remember those words just rolling towards me, and I knew it was gonna hit my midsection. And when it hit my body, I remember trembling violently and I couldn't contain myself. And I felt that these words, something was gonna come out of my mouth. I tried to hold myself back and I couldn't. And I remember yelling out loud, revealing the condition of my heart when I cried out, "No, we're not ready. That's what I did. I raised my fists
you
up like this.
You weren't even thinking this.
It came out from
your innermost. If this man is not ready, what about us? I'll tell you what. He was downloaded from heaven how to be ready. Now, when he says ready, he doesn't mean repenting of sins. He repented of his sins. He doesn't mean having the Messiah live inside of him. The Messiah lives inside of him. When he said, "I'm not ready," he meant, "I am not prepared to be involved in the next, in the greatest, and perhaps the last move of the presence of God, of the mercy of God on planet Earth." And he was commissioned on what he had to do to be ready and what you have to do to be ready. Why were you not ready?
So I come out of this encounter and I find myself back in my physical body. I'm on the floor weeping, totally distraught and disturbed by the encounter. And those words haunted me. It said for 2 hours, I lay there weeping and saying, haunted by those words, no, we're not ready. No, we're not ready. So I asked the Lord, why am I not ready? Was I talking about myself, the ministry, my family, the church in general? And after 2 hours, I heard the Holy Spirit say this to me. He says, "Son, if I took you home right now, you are ready to meet me for eternity." But then he said this, "But in the condition that your heart is in right now, you are not ready for the next great move of the Holy Spirit.
But wait a second now. Did you see miracles in your congregation?
Absolutely.
Did you see people coming to know the Messiah?
Absolutely.
Were you growing?
Absolutely.
Did you have financial problems?
Not at all.
And he wasn't ready.
And so here's what the Lord began to reveal to my heart. He began to reveal to my heart that I had become a professional minister. In other words, I had become grown so comfortable in my calling that the ministry was routine. I mean, you can get up behind a platform and, you know, my heart was still for the Lord. Don't get me wrong. I still love the Lord. But in other words, my heart was no longer on the edge, a prophetic edge. And the Holy Spirit began to reveal to me, he says, "Son, you've left your first love." It reminded me of the church of Ephesus in Revelation 2, where the Spirit of the Lord rebuked the church for leaving her first love. Although they had great ministry, they had great doctrine, great miracles, but they left their first love. And the Spirit of God began to reveal to me, son, because you've left your first love, therefore there's a lack of humility. And the lack of humility, which I believe is a major component that we have to have restored in the preachers of America, the preachers of the Western Church, the preachers in the body of Christ, so that because the true spirit of humility is a pure dependence upon God, where there is no glory for man. There is no glory for the church, or a specific local church. There is no glory for a ministry, but he gets all the glory. And the true spirit of humility is that what John the Baptist said, I must decrease, but he must increase. And so I really believe this is an area that the Spirit of God is honing in on so that the church can understand if we truly are humble, he will exalt us. And there's many that are watching right now by television that the Holy Spirit is, I saw earlier the Spirit of God almost like take his hand and turn a spigot. And I saw a fresh release of affections. I saw a fresh release of love. And those of you that are watching right now, just be sensitive and ask the Lord. Say, Lord, would you please open up the portal of my heart? Open up the portal of my soul, because the Lord wants to download a love and affection. He wants you to feel how much he feels about you. And the reason why many of us are stuck, the minute we're not progressing, we feel like we don't feel the presence of the Lord, or we're not happy. I mean, some of the saddest Christians are Christians who are bored, and they're bored because they don't fully realize how God feels about them. And so for those of you that are watching right now, I just say in Jesus' name, receive that fresh turning of the affections of God for your life, even right now in Jesus' name. And so I just felt from the Lord that the Spirit of God was asking me to focus on two things. Son, become more dependent upon me. Seek my face. And then number two, return to your first love. We need to have every believer understand, wait a second, it's not just the pastor. It's not just the evangelist. I'm called as an individual to return back to minister to the Lord. And that's what I believe the Lord is saying. Return back to your first love. The greatest commandment is not a suggestion. It's a commandment. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, mind, soul, and strength. And when you look at the Bible from Genesis to Revelation, it's about one thing, Sid. You ready? It's about a wedding. History began in Genesis chapter 1, 2, and 3. With Adam and Eve. What's that about? Man and woman becoming one. That's the wedding. First miracle of Jesus is of his ministry. Where? John chapter 2 at the wedding of Cana in Galilee. And then one of the greatest apostles, if not the greatest apostle, was Paul. And he has his revelation of the mystery. You know about the mystery, the Jew and Gentile becoming one. But he takes it further, and the Lord reveals to him, this mystery I'm talking about is the heart of God and the plan of God coming to pass from all of eternity, which is what? God and man becoming one. And he uses the picture of a husband and a wife. He says, I speak to you a mystery, but I'm speaking concerning Christ and the church. And then we have Revelation chapter 22 and verse 17. One of the last statements that the Spirit of God says about the end times is this, and the Spirit and the bride say, come. I believe the greatest identity that's about to be released to the body of Christ. We know what it is to be a child of God. We know what it is to be a son of God. And many of us know what it is to be a friend of God. But the greatest revelation and the greatest identity, the most intimate relationship on earth, is that between a man and a woman, a husband and a wife. And the Spirit of God is releasing this revelation that Christ is the bridegroom and the church is the bride.
Hello, Sid Roth here with Bruce Allen. Bruce, tell me about the time, and I'm sure this has happened many times, but you were caught up into heaven and you saw someone you knew.
Yeah, Sid, that was unusual. I was in a season of prayer and just worshiping God, and suddenly I was in heaven, paradise. And there was great activity going on, like bustling. I don't know how to describe that. Almost like Christmas in a mall. And all of a sudden,
almost like all the activity is going on because the holiday or the event's about ready to happen. You have to get everything in place. So there's a lot of activity going on.
Much activity.
Heaven. Yeah.
And my aunt, who had died about 7 years previously to that, walked up. And she was all excited. She said, Bruce, it is so exciting. And I said, what's so exciting? She said, the preparation for the marriage supper of the Lamb is almost complete. And heaven is abuzz with this news and excited because it's the culmination, the completion. And she said, and not only that, many individuals are visiting heaven from earth right now to go back with the testimony that people should be prepared because he's coming back shortly.
You know, that's the message I'm hearing from many people, yeah. That he's coming back soon. But the thing that's so unusual is even children are carrying this message back. Yeah.
There was a young girl in Singapore that had been in one of our meetings where we were teaching your birthright is to see and go as a Christian. And she caught the revelation and began to be caught into paradise. And at that particular time, I was visiting, I saw my aunt at that time. I saw this young girl, she was 8 years old, appear off to my left. She looked at me, smiled and waved, grabbed the hand of Jesus and skipped off with him. A year later, Sid, I'm back in Singapore and happened to have dinner with the grandmother and she was there and she said, I saw you in heaven and you were talking to your aunt.
The Lord has spoken with me about a very, very significant event that is about to take place on the earth this past night. And in that conversation, I saw the visions of the Lord. And in that vision, I found myself looking up into the sky. And as I looked up into the sky, all of a sudden, heaven opened and tremendous glory came. And I saw the Lord coming in his powerful, shocking, and tremendous glory. The unassailable glory, the unequaled glory of the Lord. And I was able to see his crown as he came. Then as he was coming, the Lord, from where he had lifted me, made me also see the church. I saw down there, the church down there. And the church that I saw had glorious garments. Their countenance and appearance was very glorious. So it was clean and glowing. But again, as the Lord was coming from heaven in his glory, from where I was, he also made me see the church. Then I saw him come all the way and take the glorious church. Now, this is the most important message for all the time ever since the Bible was written. That one day, the nations and the church, the church that constitutes the righteous bride, the holy bride from all nations, may one day be taken up, qualified to be snatched up, to be taken up into the glorious eternal kingdom of Jehovah. So I have seen the Messiah coming for his church, coming across the clouds with the clouds and the glory and coming down to the church to take the church. So these are the days in which we live, the times that the Bible well spoke about for a very long time. And I'm going to read here a scripture. I'm reading from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and I'm reading verses 16 to 18. And it says, for the Lord himself will descend. I'm reading Amplified, the Amplified version. Again, I repeat, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, 16 to 18. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a loud cry of summons, with the shout of an archangel, and with the blast of the trumpet of God, and those who are departed this life, who have departed this life in Christ, will rise first. Verse 17. Then we, the living ones, who remain on the earth, shall simultaneously be caught up along with the resurrected dead in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so always through the eternity of the eternities, we shall be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort and encourage one another with these words. And the scripture that I've just read in the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 16, 17, and 18, he talks about those who are dead in Christ that shall first be resurrected and then raptured in their glorious bodies. And then he says, we who are still alive, who remain on the earth, will also then hence be translated and then to be caught up with them and through the eternity of the eternities be with the Lord forever. Many Christians have died, but in this scripture, the Lord is strictly referring to those who at the point of death were holy Christians. That there may not be any mistake on this. When he says those who are dead in Christ, who are asleep in Christ, he talks about those who are asleep in Christ meaning born again and holy, just like the Messiah is. If there was a Christian that died unholy, that one will not enter. And then those who are living as that event takes place, who are eventually translated and taken up, are the living holy Christians. The living sinful Christians will remain here. The weight of sin will not allow them to be taken up. They'll remain. They'll be too heavy to go, owing to the weight of sin. Owing to the fact that sin still obeys gravity. And that sin would still pull them back. But the holy righteous Christians will have defeated the laws of nature. They will have transformed into another life. And so, I have seen the coming of the Messiah, and when I woke up, I trembled. I shook, because I did not know whether it would wait until now for me to give this message here. And I asked the Lord, please hold it until I give this message. And now the Lord has privileged us, but we have all now partaken of this warning and announcement. I have seen the Messiah coming. There is now need for the church and all people of the earth to turn away from sin. The signs are very clear right now. If you see what's happening in Europe, you see what's happening in the Arab world, Iraq, Nigeria, wherever, every nation really. You see the whole earth is now gripped up, is caught up in this war on terrorism. The fear, the distress has not been seen before. The signs are very clear. Anybody can see and know that we have never, ever been this way before as the earth. And hence, the Messiah is coming. May those who have ears listen to the voice of the Lord. Shalom.
Wednesday morning, around 3:30, 4 o'clock in the morning, God gave me a dream. And this dream had to do about the rapture. In the beginning of the dream, he showed me great disaster that's going to happen here on earth. He showed me people crying. He showed me buildings tumbling. He showed me weapons of mass destruction that are going to be used, human against human, country against country. Just a massive massacre here on earth, something that the human race has never, ever, ever experienced before. And I was outside in the dream, and you know, this was occurring. So you know how newscasters are, they're out there and they're being nosy with their cameras, and they're filming all of this. And we're watching TV, and everybody in their houses are watching TV with what's happening. And then all of a sudden, someone says, look up at the sky. So I look up at the sky, and I see these round, metallic, bright things just zooming in the sky really fast, faster than an airplane or whatever, just zooming very quickly. And all I could think of is Ezekiel chapter 1, what Ezekiel experienced, that the Lord revealed to him, those round sphere things. So once those sphere things started zooming, all of a sudden I started feeling light in body. And I'm like, what's happening? And I'm just feeling light, and then all of a sudden I started ascending to the heavens. And I just seen people, you know, not everybody obviously, but people ascending to the heavens. And it was just an awesome feeling, a feeling that I couldn't control. I know that we as humans, we try to want to control things, and I was trying to bring myself back down, but I couldn't. It was uncontrollable, just ascending to the heavens. And we were ascending into outside of the earth's atmosphere, to the point that when I looked down, I seen the whole world at my feet, where I would see the stars, and the stars were close enough to where I could touch them. And there I was in heaven. I seen some of the sisters here in the church. I seen Pat. And we were just so overjoyed to see each other up there. Just a joy. I cannot describe to you the joy that was up there. Just to see each other. Just to be right next to each other. And then every time somebody would say, glory, glory to God, I seen thousands and thousands of angels worshiping the Lord, lifting up their hands, and every time we would praise God, these angels, a massive amount of angels worshiping along with us. But then at this time, this is where I was saddened at heart, because I didn't see some of my loved ones there. Some of my loved ones that I thought would be there were not there. And then he revealed to me some of these people, which were my close relatives. And one of these close relatives, she was holding her daughter, just as an example. And then all of a sudden, her daughter disappeared, and all she had were her clothes and her arms. And she went crazy. She went ballistic. I don't know if any of you have ever dealt with psych patients. I know I have. And they, you know, they are in a different mind state. But she was just acting like a psych patient. She went so crazy because her daughter disappeared in midair. And then all of a sudden, I felt a breath go all over my body. And when I looked at my arms, even my hair, it was flowing like fire. Like fire, my body was on fire. Not a fire that was burning my flesh, no. It was a different kind of fire. And then I heard a majestic voice telling me, preach my word. And when he said that, I got even more on fire. Preach my word. And he revealed to me names whom I needed to speak to about his salvation. And then from there, I woke up. And even while I was sitting up in bed, my body was on fire. I said, oh Jesus, what's happening to me? Even my toes, when I would wiggle my toes and go like this to my hands, I was on fire. That I walked around my room and I was on fire. Now if I could add this, if you would let me. He's the boss, I need to ask him. There was this urgency that I felt during that dream. An urgency. God is not coming soon. God is around the corner. He's not coming soon. Let me clarify this. He is around the corner. And the thing about the Lord is, throughout the whole Bible, that he doesn't surprise us. He forewarns us when something's going to happen. And he is forewarning us now. Because on that day, a lot of us who are not worshiping in spirit and in truth, who are not righteous and holy, guess what? You're not going. And you're going to be left behind, I'm telling you right now, to a world full of destruction, where every corner you will go, there will be mourning, there will be crying. No one will be able to comfort you. And I know that the Lord revealed this to me, not only for myself and for me to, you know, preach the word of God to my family, but I know He also, you know, wants to say this to you. And I do hope that you take this special visitation under consideration. And I do hope with all my heart that you do start becoming righteous in the hands of the Lord. Amen. God bless.
God bless. Praise the Lord. Cece told me in there, when she was talking to me about that two countries will be involved in, she saw mass weapons of mass destruction against our country. And I think what the why the Lord has given things like that is to show us to pray for our country. And our defense of our country is not our military might. It is God. Yes, it is. We need to pray for revival in this country, that God will sweep across this land and bring revival. It's overdue. We need it. We need to pray. All of us at noon every day, pray as the Lord reminds you. Pray for revival. Do it in unison together. Amen? Hallelujah.
I then left this beautiful garden and went to the lovely street of gold, and the Lord told me, touch. Yes, it's pure gold. Go and tell my children that very soon they're going to walk on these streets of gold by the hand of the one who gives life. Oh, how great it is to walk in those streets of gold. After that, I saw a splendid throne surrounded by angels, archangels, and seraphs. They were continually praising God, the one who was on the throne, saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Heaven and earth are filled with His glory. Amen. Time has come to lift up holy hands unto me and to praise me. At the same time, I saw the river of the water of life flowing from the throne. I also saw the tree of life, and at the other end I saw the rainbow and the river of crystal. Then I asked the Lord, who is on this throne? He answered, it's my Father, the Lord of hosts. I told him, can I see the Father? No, it's not yet time, the Lord answered. Even though I did not see the Father, the one who was on the throne was mighty. I saw thunder and flashes of lightning coming from the throne, and I heard praises. Jesus told me, do you hear these praises? These are the praises of those who are redeemed. I saw seven angels, each one of them holding a golden bowl, and seven other angels, each holding a trumpet. Lord, who are these angels? The Lord answered, the seven bowls that the angels hold are filled with the wrath of God. They will soon be poured out, and when the trumpets sound, my church, those Christians who live according to the will of my Father, will be caught up. They will no longer be on earth during the great tribulation. Before the Antichrist manifests himself, this man of sin, my church will hear the last trumpet sound, and they will meet me in the air. I was there, dear friend, in front of a great throne, and I did not have any notion of time. A moment later, Jesus showed me how His church, the true believers, will be caught up. I saw this in vision, thousands of people disappearing. This happened worldwide, and TV and radio gave the news of the disappearance. Newspapers with big headlines in red also brought out the news. The Lord told me, the news will soon happen. If the judgments of my Father have not yet come upon the earth, it's because of the faithful Christians who really love me. After that, I saw the appearance of the man of sin. He was saying to the inhabitants of the earth, I'm bringing you peace and safety. And immediately people forgot the event that had just taken place. Jesus told me, look carefully. I saw in the vision the seven angels with the seven bowls. Dear friend, what was happening was difficult to describe. I saw the angels pouring out the seven bowls of wrath on the earth. Trumpets started sounding. God was pouring out his judgments on the inhabitants of the earth, and the whole country and whole countries disappeared. The Lord told me, "Look, all these people were part of my church, and some were even pastors." Because I did not fully understand this, I asked the Lord, "How is it that your people have been left so numerous in the great tribulation? How is it that there are also pastors among them, those who preach your word?" Jesus answered, "Yes, they had preached my word, but they were not living in accordance with my word." Then the Lord allowed me to see another multitude of pastors, he told me. "Those pastors were not preaching my word as it is written. They thought that my word was not adapted to their century. They had too much favor towards those who were given a lot of tithes because they were more interested in material prosperity. Go and tell my servants that I am the one who called them, and that silver and gold belong to me, and I give them according to my greatness and glory. Tell them to preach my word as it is written. There are many, those who give another interpretation to my word. My word is my word, and no one can change it. It must be preached as it is written. There are many among my people who distort my word for their own profit."
But he devotes his life now to being a chaplain. He was a chaplain in the army for how many years?
Almost 30 years.
But the thing that intrigues me is when these visits to heaven started in 2008. Explain.
Well, in 2008, two things happened sort of simultaneously. First of all, God put it on my heart to pray for Israel every day. Every day I would get face down on the floor and repent for the things our nation had done to Israel and cry out for shalom in Jerusalem and shalom in Israel. And about that same time, I went to a large revival. And one night I came home late from the revival, and when I lay down in bed, my head hit the pillow, I was literally translated to heaven. I stood in this place in heaven. Some people call it a throne room, but it was not really a room. It was huge. But I was standing looking at the throne of Jesus, and I was in so much awe of Jesus. I was literally paralyzed with awe of Jesus. And as I looked at him, just love flowed out of me, and I just felt like this is my Jesus. And I felt like I was just connecting with him in such a powerful way. And it was a life-changing experience for me.
Well, you know, and then multitudes have been, that when he teaches, have had experiences of going to heaven. But why is it, as a new believer, but I'm hearing so many people now, believers, are having visits to heaven. Why is that happening now?
Well, Sid, I believe the reason it's happening now is that time is very short. In the first letter of John, he says, this is the last hour. And I believe that God is getting the bride ready, and he's calling people to heaven to give them the instructions, the preparations, the correction, whatever discipline they may need to be ready. And I believe that we're at the time of the great end time harvest, and God is calling the harvesters to heaven to train them and to empower them and to gift them to go back into the harvest to win lost souls for the kingdom.
I want to talk to you about I got to visit heaven, and it changed my life. It marked me. I'll never be the same. It was about 2 years, a little over 2 years ago, when I actually left my body and went to heaven. I was at home, and an angel came into my room, and suddenly I was in the spirit. I had just wakened up. It was about 10:30 in the morning. And as I woke up, I saw this angel. I left my body, and he took me. He said, I'm here to bring you to heaven. Well, I'm sent to bring you. And he said, take my hand. And we shot up out of the house, my house. And then as I looked down, it was like a Google map thing, you know. Yeah. And I went higher and higher until finally I was out in space, you know, and then it was like Star Trek sort of. Then I looked forward and we were going faster and faster, and it was just streaks of light, the stars, it was, you know. And we approached what looked very similar to Earth. It was a planet. We descended into this angel and I descended into this planet, and this is perfect. It looked a lot like Earth, and we we came and when we touched down, I saw mountains, I saw snow, I saw beautiful. I mean, it was like super high def. Everything was alive. And I was so grateful to be out of this body. Let me tell you something, this body, just living in this body is pain. Because we were born again, but God had to leave us in this body. We're getting a new body. And that one, oh, it'll never get old. You don't have to put stuff on it. You don't have to do all that stuff. And I was walking, and we landed in like this valley. And I'll tell you a few things I saw. One was the most beautiful wildflowers I had ever seen, different colors. And there were colors that I had never seen before. The flower was singing. Nature sings there. And everything sings the praises of God. They're singing, and everything has its unique voice. How do they sing? I don't know. And the angel is sitting there, waiting for me to, I'm going, wow. And then we walked, and as we walked, it looked like we were going faster than you could walk. And we passed by a waterfall, and the waterfall was like, first of all, I saw a rainbow in it. There was a sun. It was just like Earth, except it was perfect. Perfect, perfect, perfect. Perfect nature. And the rainbow had like 40 colors in it. And it was refracting off this waterfall. And the waterfall sounded like an ocean, sounded like a choir of angels and a full symphony orchestra singing at the same time. And then as I looked at it, it was shaped, we came in from above, and it was shaped, it was like a Jewish star. And there were 12 tents in the different points of the star, in different places. And then there was a center, there's a center pavilion and a table there. And it didn't look so big, but then when it got there, I realized, wow, this thing is huge. It was just thousands of people could sit under each. And then there was a flag. It was like a cone. It was all white. And at the top of each of these pavilions, there was a flag. And the flag was for each tribe of Israel, the 12 tribes. And so I went in there, and I saw the same, very similar wedding, outdoor wedding banquet. But the difference was, there were no angels preparing it. It was all ready. Everything was ready. The Lord turned to me and said, everything is now ready. Do you know what this is? I said, no, sir, I don't know. What is this? He said, these are prepared for the 144,000 that are soon of your people from the 12 tribes. This is a special banquet that is prepared for them when they finish their work. And then all of a sudden I look in the center, and the highest one was this, it looked like solid diamonds. It was a beautiful robe, solid diamonds. It was suspended really high in the air, and I mean the highest of any of the mantles. And at first it was just bright. But then as I looked at it, it got brighter and brighter and brighter until every one of those diamonds was like a sun. It was blinding, and I fell on my face, and I couldn't look anymore. And then it went back down in intensity, and it was just bright, shining, beautiful. Millions of diamonds looked like, except it's prettier than a diamond. I don't know what it is. It's a stone of heaven. And he said, do you know what this is? And I knew it had something to do with the Lord. I said, no, sir, what is it? He said, this is the robe that I will wear when I return to the earth. For I shall be clothed, and he quoted me the word of God. And it will be dipped in blood. And in other words, so he said, this is yet to come. I said, whoa. And then I wasn't there anymore. And he says, there's one more place I want you to see. But he said, you must tell my people that I'm coming soon. All is now ready. And he actually said to me, he said, all of heaven is on its feet. He says, we are ready to come. And then he said this to me, and at first it was very puzzling. He says, I don't know when it is. It could be at any moment. I said, surely you know. He says, only the Father knows. He said, all is now ready. Tell them that I'm coming and my reward is with me. So then finally, we stood in front of this beautiful, probably the most majestic of all of the buildings I had seen. And it really did. It looked like a cathedral, and it looked like the Hall of Versailles, because it was long, also a long hallway. The doors opened, and it was Gothic, you know. They just opened, and we walked in, and it was the most beautiful marble floor. It was, it was like the Lord was leading me. I looked to the left, and I saw on the left a small table that was in black velvet, and it was gold table that was draped black velvet, and on that table was a crown. And then I looked up, and the ceiling was arched like this, right? I look up, and there are the most beautiful paintings of that person that I'd ever seen. The most beautiful painting. I mean, it was like Raphael and Michelangelo. They were painted. He said some of these were painted by the great artists here. Some were painted by angels, and some were painted by me. I painted some of them. I said, oh. And these paintings were very special because each one represented, that was like, sometimes there was 10 great deeds that were done by that person. These were the crowns of the overcomers. This is the Hall of Crowns, he said. And on each side, there was a crown and on a table. And every 10 to 20 feet, there was another table. And some of the crowns were not that elaborate. Some of them were just bursting with jewels, colored gemstones, jewels. Some of them just had solid diamonds that looked like diamonds that went up like in a flare. Like one of them was like 8 feet. I mean, it looked just huge, just that same kind of diamonds I saw on the robe of Jesus. And he said, do you know what these diamonds are? Of course, I said, no, sir, what are they? And he said, diamonds are nothing compared to these. These are like, wow. He said, they represent souls. These are soul winners crowns. They're different kinds of crowns. And he said, everything that you do in love is recorded and rewarded.
About the end time. Jesus came to me and sat at my bedside.
I want to talk with you like this today.
I naturally realized it was about the end time. Is it about the end? I asked him.
Yes. I am going to talk about the end time with you.
In December 2006, Jesus showed me rapture in the vision. When I was praying, I suddenly saw a blue sky. Then I saw people down on the land in small silhouette. Suddenly clouds started to rise up here and there simultaneously. At first, I was bewildered at the sight and soon realized its rapture. I looked at the scene in surprise, joy, and deep emotion. God told me to write down something after the scene.
_ There will be huge famines and earthquakes before the Great Tribulation. The heaven and earth will become dark. Those who are looking for me will betray me. Men will pursue men, and women will pursue women to an extreme degree. Stay awake and keep praying. Listen to my words and practice them. Most of all, practice love. Love will overcome everything. Satan will be defeated by love. The servants who are awake and pray when I come will know when I will come and make preparations in advance. I will gather them in a place. Try to gather and pray. Those who stand alone will fall down. Fear me and make effort to pray. I will help you. I will help you by granting you great power and faith that are not like before. I will lift up my people without much tribulation. _
Jesus also showed me another scene. I saw a soldier in a military cap on my right side. I thought he was a Chinese soldier. He was in war. I saw another scene on my left side. The army was in formation and shot cannons. They felt like missiles. The both sides were in a fierce confrontation. God recently told me something about China. He said China was being used for mission for Israel and also used by the tool of Satan. In other words, the Chinese Christians will engage in the mission for Israel, while the Chinese government will be in a political confrontation with Israel. After watching the scene, Jesus told me,
there will be an alliance formed between China and Arab Emirates at the end, which is just right before rapture. They will fight in war against Israel. That is a sign of the end.
John the Apostle came up to me, bent over, and kissed on my hand. I hugged him. You were in Patmos Island when writing the book of Revelation, right? I was happy with the heaven description at the end of the book and very much scared of the tribulation parts in the middle of it.
When I first saw that, I was also very scared and trembling hard.
Will those who received Holy Spirit go through the tribulation?
Those who love Lord and those who are loved by Lord will suffer from hardship very likely if they enter. They will not go through the 7-year great tribulation. Lord will calling them before the 7-year great tribulation. They will be ready as brides and spread the last gospel with the love given by Lord. Then, they will be lifted in a cloud simultaneously.
Then what kind of people will be left in great tribulation? Will they include those who received Holy Spirit?
There are few believers are left also in order to help others with God's permission.
What kind of people will be left behind generally?
They will include those who listened to God's voice and regarded it as a joke, or refused to believe it. They will be subject to severe, harsh, and deep suffering in the Great Tribulation.
Martyrs during tribulation. I was having a conversation with believers. I felt a huge tremble. It grew more powerful until I could not endure it. All energy slipped out of my body, and Lord took me to heaven once again. Jesus said,
I will show you the punishment that will be applied to those who are left behind during the tribulation.
Soon I saw a scene before me. People were scratching here and there in the body with a painful facial expression. They were covered with black insects here and there, too. The insects got attached to their bodies and bit them painfully. They were scratching the itchy bites, which turned into reddish rashes, which would in turn make their faces swollen like balloons. Lord, will those who were chosen will be left behind and get punishment?
All those who failed to be prepared as brides will be left behind and enter the tribulation. But I will provide them with solid faith to overcome the tribulation. In the end, they will get over the tribulation through the faith I gave them.
Then will those who were not chosen by you go to hell?
What do you think? What do you think I will do with them?
I believe you will save even them, as well. Smiling at me, pleased, he said,
I am full of love and mercy. I will grant my grace of salvation to those who listen to my voice and love me even though they are not chosen by me.
I recalled the parable of wedding feast in Matthew 22, 1:14. The people who were invited didn't come. The king asked his servant to invite all in the street. Those who come later were not originally invited but had honor to be in the banquet. The next scene took place somewhere like a prison. The prison building was in a L shape. I was looking down at the yard in the air and saw prisoners standing in a circle. There was a man lying on a cross in the middle of people with his hands and feet tied. Evil men tried to saw him half in the stomach and kill him. The prisoners in the surrounding were also shaking with fear.
I will make some of them grow in faith further and die martyrs. I will give them the glory of martyrdom. The faith of the left behind people will get stronger through the martyrdom.
Lord would pour down faith for him to die martyr when the sawing began. He would then God opened up his spiritual eyes, when he shouted loud, I see Lord standing in glory. Lord is waiting for me, standing by the throne. People who are left behind in the world, look at Lord who is trying to save and wait for us. Hallelujah. He then faced his death in the middle of huge joy and praise. There was a golden wagon in standby beside him already. The messengers of death would sit down with their arms and feet crossed far down the cross and merely look at the scene as if they got nothing to do. It was at that moment that the prisoners grew stronger in faith and started to encourage each other. Lord guides many martyrs to martyrdom for that. They will, of course, receive rewards for glory and nobility as I saw them at the place of martyrdom. Why aren't they thrown in prison?
They are in prison because they refused to receive a mark on the forehead. Believers refused to receive a mark on the forehead.
Does that mean it is 666? Not answering the question, he said,
a microcomputer chip will be installed in their foreheads. Those who do not have the mark will have a difficult time eating, dressing, and drinking. However, those who were chosen by me will know it in advance and refuse to accept the mark. going through some difficult hardship regarding eating, dressing, and drinking.
I was shown with a vision about people getting the mark on the foreheads. It looked like a device to scan barcodes at the counter and was smaller than it. The device beamed at someone's forehead, and the subject showed no indications on the surface. A little bit later, the evil people began to identify those who were not marked. Of those who refused to receive mark, some would escape to fields and mountains to avoid the evil men, while others would be captured and sent to prison.
My children I chose will never be taken by the evil force, not even a single person.
At that moment, I knelt down before him and praised him as follows.
And God said, showing you the great and terrible last day. I didn't know what was about to happen. And then the whole sky was full of Jesus. The look on his face was love, compassion, but it was so final. How do you capture that look in destiny? And if anyone has ever wanted to know how they're going to see Jesus on the last day,
up next.
There was a beautiful grand piano, I remember, and we were all standing there. There were about 30 pastors and a missionary couple from India, and the music started playing. And I remember looking on the back of the sofa on the table, and there was a little Ark of the Covenant with the Israelites carrying the covenant. Mm-hmm. And as soon as I just shut my eyes, and all of a sudden was taken in a fast bullet elevator to heaven. And there I met God, and the place was so full of love and peace, and it was so magnificent, and it was about thousands and thousands of voltages of light, you know, so mm-hmm. it was hard for my eyes to adjust, but I knew where I was. And then he came right down to me from the throne, and he held my chin, and he said, Rivers, I love you. His red eyes were just blazing right through mine. We were nose to nose. And he said, I never asked for the gift that I gave you. I never asked for it back. And I knew that he meant my music at that time, my voice, because the enemy had stolen. He had stolen so much from us. And so he wasn't reprimanding. He wasn't angry. I knew he understood, but and he, of course, there's no anger in heaven, so I was just fully loved. And then all of a sudden, I look next to me. Well, first he shows me the throne, because I see around him. Mm-hmm. And the throne of God is about 10,000 football fields, huge, the steps leading up to it, and he is that massive. This is not a small God that we serve. We serve a mighty, powerful, massive God. And then I look next to me, and here's Jesus. And this he's so handsome in his starched robes. And I often wonder, like, who does his laundry? He's always so put together, you know? But this, I could see his, you know, I could see his sandals and this in the sash. And he said, I want to show you. And as far as I could see to the right and then to the left, he showed me millions upon millions of these. I say they're the heavenly beings, the angelic beings, and millions of them were singing all in unison the most glorious sounds. So beautiful. I was the
like holy, holy, holy.
No words. I just heard the sounds.
Oh wow.
Then I looked down and I was on the sea of glass, the golden sea, that pathway, and it made it went all the way through heaven. It was so beautiful. And then he took me into the altar. The area where the altar was, and around the altar, this magnificent light show with skyscraper beams. I mean, each beam was massive, and I looked up, and each beam that was on this light show, trillions and trillions of sapphires. This one had rubies, this one had diamonds, then this one pearls as large as a house. I mean, it was a magnificent light show. And then he said, he knew I did not want to leave. It's just all fear was gone, and I wanted to stay forever. Perfect love. And then he must have read my mind. He said, it's time for you to go back. You cannot stay. It's not time for you to be here. So as I came to in that living room, in front of the couch, I was still standing, and my body was on fire. And it was like I was standing in ice cubes and on fire at the same time. Every cell was electrified in my body. the day before, the night before that we're supposed to go pray for this pastor, I'm awakened in the middle of the night to this incredible screaming and screeching. I think that there are about a million people marching around this little hotel on the train line out of Helsinki. And I'm thinking to myself as I come to, what would they want to kill the Teskeys for? We're just here to pray for the Lutheran pastor, right? And so all of a sudden, before my eyes opened, God said, do not open your eyes. I'm showing you the great and terrible last day. And it was as my body went like a bag of cement, I was shocked that he would. I didn't know what was about to happen. And then all of a sudden, the blue, the azure blue sky that I see is incredible. It was a panoramic of the entire planet Earth. I heard but did not see the clouds rolling back. I mean, massive waves of clouds that roll back. And if anyone has ever wanted to know how they're going to see Jesus on the last day, he took up the entire sky. The whole sky was full of Jesus. So he's like planted his feet on planet Earth. So, there is Michael and Gabriel, the angels, standing next to him on either side. Mm-hmm. He is so magnificent, but he is fierce. It was a moment. The look on his face was love, compassion, but it was so final. How do you capture that look in destiny? It's it was the moment of the moment. And behind them were stacked up millions of the warring angels. They are the most magnificent golden angels. Their wings, they're the essence of life in the every cell in their being. I mean, it was just shimmering. Their wings were just kind of moving, and they were focused totally on Commander-in-Chief. Mm. Like, with the command, they would do anything. Mm. As they appear, the whole earth goes silent. Have you ever thought about whole planet Earth? Not one bird, they weren't chirping, nothing. All I could hear was humanity just breathing, and it was heavy breathing. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, bam, 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 I heard billions of knees hit the ground all over planet Earth. So my mind, I felt like every it was exploding with the sounds.
Every knee shall bow.
Yeah. And it was like dominoes. It was a ripple effect that went all over the planet. And
thank you, Lord.
They're down. And then three times, all of humanity says Jesus three times. And the ripple effect, even the sound of our breath to Jesus and all the angels, it was like a nuclear fallout, you know, the ripple, or even if you drop a stone in a pond and how it goes. And as Jesus hits them, they all kind of like, they just come back with the sound. Mm-hmm. And then we all say Jesus again, and then Jesus. And then the most frightening thing, everyone that had spit, that had mocked, had hated him, the vileness, had rejected him. I felt so helpless. I was totally helpless for them, because in their minds, I could hear the death knell. They were screaming and screeching. And then I wondered, was that what I had heard when I was awakened at that sound, that first sound that night? And I laid there. I was released from the vision. And I laid there. It must have been an hour. But I just looked over to the wall, and I could see, you know, it said 3 a.m. And then I looked at my husband, like, very slowly. That's all I could move, my eyes and my face. And I laid there, and my question to myself was, or to God, was, why me? Oh, my goodness. Mm-hmm. This is too much. I mean, but I was so grateful that in my whole life, that was really, of all the encounters, that changed everything in my life. I want the people that are watching, that they must, as the grandparents and the parents of these little ones who will see the terrible, the great and terrible last day, we may not tarry, but they will see it and they will have to be strong. So I believe that the kingdom of God must rise up. You must come out of the pews. You've got to stop being dead on arrival. We are not in the hospital. We are a mighty army and we have got to withstand. Mm-hmm. And the days, it says in Revelations and in Daniel and Matthew, the end times will be so great that even the followers of Jesus will give up hope. So this is a hopeful thing for the kingdom of God. But it is, I mean,
it's also a clarion call.
Yes, a clarion call.
I mean, for people who don't know the Lord, maybe you're watching today and you haven't invited Jesus into your heart and life. You haven't asked him to forgive you of your sins. The Bible says, for all have sinned.
Yeah.
And come short of the glory of God. But also says in John, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
You know that for you and I, because I've been taken to heaven several times, I've gone to the wedding place. In order for you to come there, Jesus had to bring you there into that wedding place. And you have to be invited there too. Thank you, Lord. Remember that revelation the Lord gave me where I went to that room where Jesus was, and one of the angels said, where are you going? You cannot go in there. And I heard when Jesus said to the angel, he can come. Like he'd been invited. You have to be invited in order for you to come. And the Lord is inviting everyone to come. But how many have taken him serious in the invitation? And are preparing, are trimming the lamp, getting ready to meet the Lord. How many are getting ready? And not keeping enough oil on the lamp so when he comes. That's your relationship with God. God will give you that oil for you to have if you continue to seek him. To continue to come to him. The only sad thing, you know, someone shared with me, I believe it was today or yesterday, a testimony that he saw the gate of heaven shut. And so people could not come in. Someone shared this with me. I don't know if it was a dream or someone shared this with me. It was, I don't know if it was a sister or brother. He says, I saw the doors of heaven being shut. And I saw people that could not come in. They could not come in. They would turn away because the door was shut. And it was told to this person, soon. The door will be shut. That's all. It was a brother, yes. It was told to him to prepare. And it was said to him, soon. He saw this huge door that people could come through into the wedding celebration. And he heard the voice that said to him, soon, the door is going to be shut. And no one can come in no more. It's in the word. And he said he looked at all the people that were outside that could not come in. And he heard how loud and powerful it was when the door was shut. He knew no one could open that door but God. That's how powerful the doors are, he said. He said, Elby, you couldn't even imagine how tall those doors are. And how I never seen such a heavy doors. And I knew no one can open the door but God. I just knew it. I had that knowledge right there. That no one can open those doors. And I saw when they were shout, boom. And he heard the voice, soon, the door is going to be shut. There were still people coming in until the door was shut. And he said he woke up crying from that revelation of the Lord that the door was shut. I said, oh, wow. I'm glad when people share things like this, man. I get real joy and happy because then I can share with other people. The door is going to be shut because it's what the Lord is saying to me. And when I get these confirmations of people that get these revelations, I rejoice for people to understand this is not my own making. Hallelujah. That's another word I heard, that the time of grace will be over. Brother Bob even reminded me this early on the phone that the Lord has said this to me. When was it, Sunday? Sunday, I heard the Lord says to me, time, it's over. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Yes, he just confirmed it to me. Time is over, the Lord says to me. And the Lord just also confirmed to me, yes, the door will be shut. He just confirmed it to me. He said, yes, the door will be shut. Time is over. He just confirmed that to me, and that the door will be shut too. He just confirmed to me. I still feel his anointing as he spoke to me. Brothers and sisters, this is it. I'm telling you, this is it. And when he said this to me on Sunday, I wasn't expecting that from the Lord, and he just spoke that to me. And I had to say it because he was having me say it. Hallelujah. Glory be to the Lord. The door will be shut. The door will be shut. And time is over. I don't know how much time we have. I just don't know. I just don't know. I hear God. I obey God. We seek God, and that's it. Hallelujah. We're not trying to figure out time. The Lord told me to stop trying to figure out time. He said that to me back in April 2014. Stop figuring out time, my son. It is not for you and anyone to know, he says. It is not for you or anyone to know, but only God. And that's it. We don't need to try to figure out time. We just tell the Lord, thank you, Lord. He just confirmed it to me. We just say the Lord is coming. The Lord is coming, and that's it. For people to prepare, he's coming soon. That's what his word said. That's what we say. He's coming soon. Thank you, Lord. We just need to be ready. Ready, brothers and sisters.
Yes, brothers and sisters, I would like to start off by just introducing, what I'm going to talk about. I'm going to be mainly talking about, which is going to be about being ready and the times we're in, and about the transformation, as Brother Aaron said, time is really up and things really are about to happen. I'd like to start off with Galatians 2:20, where it says, I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. We need to grasp this scripture to the fullness. We need to live this. This has to be a reality in our lives, because when this scripture is fulfilled to the full in our hearts, we have the complete Holy Spirit. What happens is the Spirit of God becomes one with us, because we reject every single thing about ourselves, because it is not us that we strive to please. We don't think of pleasing our flesh. We don't think of pleasing our brothers and our sisters, but we only think of pleasing God, because we keep hearing this every single day. We know that is what we're supposed to do. We know that we're supposed to be focusing on pleasing God. We know that we're supposed to be focusing on pleasing the Holy Spirit, but sometimes we don't always do that. And we have to be really careful now, because there's a lot of deceiving spirits. Because, you know, the Word of God says, you know, there's going to be a time the Lord is going to release a delusion, a lie, to deceive many people. And right now, so many people are believing that lie, and they're trying to even corrupt God's people who believe the truth. There's so much lies going on about the world and about the times we're in, and, you know, about so many theories, so many doctrines of demons and of lies that are coming in to deceive people. So we have to be careful. But what I just really wanted to let everyone know is just how to really fulfill the scripture in Galatians 2, you know, fulfilling it by letting God really be the one that lives through you is a gradual process, because the Word of God says, you know, work out your salvation in fear and trembling. It's a daily gradual process. And you have to learn every single day to die to your flesh and to always put God's Holy Spirit first. And as you keep building up in that, there might be times when you're my fault. There might be times when you might make mistakes, but it's not the end. When you make a mistake, it's not the end. We all make mistakes. There's sin in my heart. There's sin in everyone's heart, because we're not perfect yet. There's sins in all of our heart. But when you fall, do not be discouraged. Don't let that be the end of your story. Don't let that discourage you, because Jesus' blood is still at work. And when you call upon that name, you know, the mention of the name of Jesus, you know, you will be saved. Whosoever shall call on that name will be saved. When you call upon that name, Jesus will faithfully cleanse you and forgive you. And you're going to be cleansed, and he's going to make everything new. And as long as you love the Lord, as long as you keep fighting for Him, the Bible says that all things work together to the good of those that love God. If you really do love Him, He will use He's going to use everything to bring glory to His name. Even the most terrible, horrendous sins and abominations you committed in your life, God will use it to bring great glory to His name. And, you know, the laws that were given to us, these laws have been fulfilled by Jesus. And you know, the fullness of God's laws and God's instructions have to be completely living in our hearts. We have to have the fullness of God's instructions. We have to have it in us. And that is Jesus. When the Lord shows us that there's something wrong, we have to be grateful. And we have to praise Him and accept whatever correction He gives us and repent from it. Because time is absolutely over. You have not allowed God to cleanse you to see that things are not okay. You need to prepare. You need to get ready to come out of this world because time is absolutely over. The Lord is showing. He's showing His people. He's been showing me this. Time is up. Every single time I pray, every single day now, it's like I keep feeling this pressing in my heart that something is coming, and I know it is, and I know it's a revival, and I know it's the disaster, and I know the transformation, and it keeps hitting it in my heart. It keeps coming to me, like I keep feeling this pressing urgency, like I know that something is about to happen, and I know that is the great events that are to come, and that is the coming of our Lord Jesus. And before that, there are things that will happen, such as, you know, the great asteroid that's going to hit, the tsunami, the great earthquake, the 3 days of darkness, but there's going to be a lot, you know, a lot of horrible things, the missile explosions, the wars, a lot of all those terrible things that Jesus said will come. They are coming, but in the midst of all that, so many wonderful, glorious things are about to happen. Everything is about to change. Like, everything is changing now. The Lord told me last year, change, and everything is changing. Like, spiritual things are becoming physical, so strong. And you're going to be shining. The glory of God is going to rise upon you so mightily. The earth was dark and sin, wretched and sin. And what happened was I saw the revival coming. I saw this glory. It looked like a white sun, but everything seemed silent, and before they least expected it, it just hit, and that's how it's going to be. It's going to be so sudden and so quick, and some people will be sleeping, but then they're going to know when these things, they're going to be so happy. They're going to wake up from their beds with tears of joy because they're going to see angels in their room. They're going to see their body beginning to change. They're going to see themselves in heaven. They're going to be hearing God in ways they've never imagined. People are going to be so amazed when they see what God is about to do. And they're just going to be weeping just because of the joy that they're experiencing. It's going to be like never before. And this is really coming. But the Lord showed me that it's right now, a lot of people don't see a lot of things that are going on. But the Lord showed me that he's coming like a thief. Thieves come in silence. And the Lord is not a thief, but he chose to explain things like that. He's going to come like a thief because if we really love Him, we're going to be ready whatever time He comes. It won't matter what day, what hour, what year. If we really love Jesus, He's going to come. We're going to be ready whatever time He comes. And He's just watching us, and it's going to be quick and very sudden. And in the sunshine.
Shalom, my friends. Bob Barbie here. End Time Dreaming Division, the channel that's dedicated to watching dreams and visions, and how they point to the return of our Lord and Savior, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, and the channel that gives away free Bibles to anybody that needs one anywhere on earth. Just email me, I need a Bible, and I'll get one to you, one way or another. just email me at rpb642@gmail.com, and I'll get it to you, all right? Full address, guys here in the United States, don't forget your zip code. I'm tired of guessing zip codes. I could put your address in Google and find your zip code, but sometimes it gives you 3 or 4 zip codes, and you wonder why you don't get your Bible. Okay, so full address, guys, especially if you're international. Okay, so, and guys, if you want to help me get more Bibles out to keep Operation Bible Storm moving, Elohim bless you, thank you. I got a PayPal and the mailing address in the description box below if you want to help. I don't need your money for my bills, guys. I don't get paid to do this ministry. My rewards are in heaven for what I do here. All the money that comes in my ministry goes only into expanding the kingdom. Nothing for Bob. My rewards, like I said, are in the Shamayim. You want to do anything for me here? Pray for me for strength. All right? Because I work full time, taking care of my family and everything else in my life as I try to make time to do this ministry. So thank you for that. Guys, I have a dream I want to share with you guys. It's a rapture scenario dream. It's from Thomas. So in this dream, Thomas says here that basically it was a lovely summer's day and I was on a bus heading to Herne Bay, Kent, United Kingdom. It was about 4 p.m. and I was on the bus. There were these 3 dogs in the road holding up the bus so we couldn't go anywhere. And then the radio says a portal is coming from a different dimension. It's on its way to send you a message. So I got off the bus. Then all of a sudden there was a flash of lightning and the sky became extremely black. Then all of a sudden, a portal opened up, and it was pink and orange. A massive beam of light shot across the sky, and when all of a sudden, out of nowhere, these gigantic, huge trumpet sounds rang out. And at this point, I entered a wedding where I got married. I see my girlfriend getting married to me when there's a beautiful man with a beard and lots of angels on the sides of the church watching our wedding. Then Jesus says, give me your hand, and I touch his hand, and it feels like light is being opened, like in Star Wars, where you travel so fast. And then I arrive in space, and it was beautiful. I was dancing or walking with my family. I believe that this is a direct vision from Yahuwah and Yeshua, Jesus Christ. So let's go back to the bus part here. So we have 3 dogs here holding up the bus. 3. The dogs, I believe, are symbolic of the number 3. The Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Outer court, inner court, holies of holies. The first, the second, and the third, Shamayim. 3 parts of the Shamayim. And number 3 goes on and on and on. So we have 3 dogs here holding up this bus. Right, it's kind of like Elohim stops everything moving in the world so everybody can receive this message to get ready for the rapture. Right, he just stops the movement of everything. And they all have their complete and undivided attention on Yeshua. Okay, can you imagine that? Right, all over the world. All over the world. So, these 3 dogs are holding up the movement of mankind. And I believe we're going to pass through a portal as we travel to the third heavens, all right, where Elohim is at. And if you guys don't know where the 3 heavens are at, heaven is the Shamayim divided in 3 parts. Biblically, it's divided in 3 parts. The first heavens, the book of Genesis talks about, is the atmosphere above our earth, all right? Then the second heavens is between the atmosphere of our earth, where the birds fly and the planes fly, that atmosphere, and the outer part of our galaxy, outer edge of our galaxy, that's the second heavens. Right? The devil and his angels got kicked onto the second heavens. Not down to the earth yet. They do in the book of Revelation. And the third heavens is right around the edge of our galaxy. And it starts going off from that point. There is the third heavens. Okay, that's where Elohim is at. All right, so that's where kind of where he has everything together right now. As you notice that the angels are kicked down from the third down to the second, and eventually will be kicked down to the first heavens, where they'll be here on the earth for the tribulations, and then they're kicked down to the center of the earth. They just keep getting kicked down and down further and further and further. Anyways, moving on from that, a portal opened up, and you got a bus. And suddenly there was a flash of lightning, and the sky became extremely black. And that's very, very common as Earth begins to descend into darkness at the rapture of the church. When the bride of Christ is removed, the Earth falls in darkness very fast. As a spiritual darkness also could be a representation of volcanoes going off, pole shift. The Bible says that the sixth seal, that the sun becomes as dark as sackcloth, blacked out. The moon, red as blood, all right? Fires would cause that because they've done it before. This past summer, we have had unexpected blood moons in Canada because of the fires, okay? And, of course, you know, a super volcano is going off because of a pole shift. That's enough ash to completely block out the sun. So the sun become as dark as sackcloth, black as sackcloth, all right, at the sixth seal. And then you saw an orange beam come shooting across the sky. And all of a sudden, at this time, an orange beam shooting across the sky, as this portal's opening, he hears a loud trumpet going off, where that's totally biblical. Bible says, at the last trump, we shall be raised. All right, so that's one verse for you. Another one where he will descend with a shout with the trumpet of Elohim. Another trumpet sound, okay? Guys, this is why we always allude to the Feast of Trumpets, because the other feasts don't involve trumpets, but the Feast of Trumpets, where they believe that that's where the rapture will be fulfilled at that time, that feast day, is all about trumpets. And every time you hear about the end of the world, about the return of Christ, and about the catching away of the church, it always deals with trumpets. I believe Elohim is giving us clues. Will it happen on Rosh Hashanah this year? Or will it happen sometime around there? Because our calendars are all messed up. Alright? What do you think? I always get excited around Rosh Hashanah. Alright? Tishri. Okay? I always get excited around Yom Teruah, whichever way you want to call it. Alright? So I always get excited around that time, because to me that's like the highest probability for me in believing that's when the Nekhatef will take place. And then we go into the wedding feast of the Lamb, which is representation of Revelation 4:1. He heard a voice of a trumpet. He ascends into heaven in spirit immediately in heaven, John the Revelator. And Jesus is parallel with the bridesmaids, where the five foolish were not able to enter into the wedding feast because the door was closed. So a door opens and a door closes. Now the Bible says in Revelation chapter 3, verse 8, that Yeshua said, I will open doors that no man can close, and close doors that no man can open. So another parallel you see there. So when he enters into the wedding feast, he has his girlfriend with him, and they get married, and they see a beautiful man who is Yeshua with his angels on all sides of him and the church watching the wedding. And Jesus says, give me your hand. And he touches his hand, and he feels the power of Yeshua, the peace of Yeshua filling him. And then at this point, we go to a higher place, dancing, walk along with your family. So the wedding in the heavens is not about man and woman getting married, but the man and wife scenario down here is a representation of a marriage of Yeshua with his bride in the heavenlies. It's a model that's put in place. All right, a man and woman here, a woman submits to the man submits to the woman. They make a promise to each other. And the Bible says that two flesh becomes one. All right, well, when Yeshua gets married to us, there are two parts of the wedding, guys. There's a part where, and it operates just like a Jewish wedding, when Yeshua comes into our life, there is a spiritual bond that happens first, and then there'll be a physical bond. I'm not talking about sex. No, there's nothing like that in heaven. Don't even go there. No, not like that. All right. It's a together with him physically that happens as a form of a consummation of the wedding. All right. But here and on the earth at this point, though, Jewish men and women, when they get married spiritually first. Then a man goes, prepares a place for his wife, comes back, and takes her to his father's house. When the father says that place that he made for him and his wife is ready, he comes back and gets her. But before he leaves, they'll sit down and they'll drink wine together. It's a ceremony that happens where they get married spiritually. They are spiritually combined, but not sexually combined yet. They haven't consummated the marriage through sex yet. That's here in the human form. All right, until he leaves and comes back to get his wife when the house is ready. So Yeshua told us that he will go into the Shamayim and prepare a place for us so that when he returns, he can receive us unto himself. In his father's house are many mansions. Same parallel. So you guys see the resemblance here. When Yeshua comes to you and you give your life to Yeshua, and you accept him as your Lord and Savior, he renews your spirit. You get washed in his blood. All right. When you two come together, you become spiritually married. Get it? His spirit becomes one with your spirit and creates a completely new redeemed spirit in him that's now in your body. That spirit is in me right now. It's a redeemed spirit. The spirit that's in my body right now, that's operating this body, is a completely different spirit than what it was before I accepted Jesus as my Lord and Savior. All right? And just like the Jewish man, he'll leave his wife to be physically eventually, because they're married spiritually already. He leaves her gifts of gold or whatever. And these are gifts from the bridegroom and his father combined. And they give them to her as a promise. And then they leave, and then the son returns for her. So, what are our gifts? It's the Comforter, the Holy Spirit. There are 9 gifts of the Holy Spirit. Those gifts operate within us. Those gifts are a representation of Yeshua in us. Because when that bride receives her gifts from her bridegroom in a Jewish wedding scenario, she takes her those like necklaces and rings. She decorates herself in all his gifts. And now people say, wow, where did all that jewelry come from? That's another sign that she is spoken for. She covers her face, by the way, and she's covered in jewelry. She is spoken for. That way every guy knows, okay, I can't mess around with her. Okay? God makes it easy for the Jewish men to understand. Okay, she's spoken for. Her face is covered and she's covering beautiful jewelry. Some man has spoken for this woman. Okay? So the same thing here. We are covered in the jewelry of the spirit of the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, that Yeshua and his father, Yahuwah, shared together. That is jewelry all over us. Alright? As a representation. That we are covered for him, and the veil is there now, but soon the veil will be removed, and we will be with him forever. So when Yeshua comes to you, you get married spiritually, just like the Jewish man and woman. All right? That is why when Joseph and Mary were together, they were together spiritually, combined spiritually, the first part of that marriage, but they did not consummate the marriage yet. This is why there was so much turmoil with Joseph, because Mary was already pregnant with Jesus and he never had sex with her yet. But the Bible says that he would divorce her and put her away quietly. So some of you don't understand that. Okay? That's how Jewish custom works. Okay? So they're married spiritually for about a year, and then there is a actual ceremony where he takes the bride into his chambers in his father's house. They leave the wedding ceremony for 7 hours. And come back and present the cloth with blood on it to the father and say, your daughter is a virgin. This is for you, to her father. Proof to you. Now, isn't it interesting? When Yeshua returns to the earth, But the bride of Christ, with all of us, his bride, riding horses, what does the Bible say? The Bible says he's wearing a robe dipped in blood. Alright, it was dipped in blood, just like the sheep that has the blood of the woman from her virginity gets filled with blood. He presents the bride, the woman, his bride, to everybody, that saying that she was pure. Just like he will present us to the world, his bride, saying that she is pure. To all the accusers, Satan, who is our accuser, for us coming back as the bride of Christ on horses. And in Jewish custom, the groom shows it to everybody who may have been accusers of that woman that he married. So just a quick little teaching there for you. So here he is. He gets married to his girlfriend, and it's representation of the marriage of the bride and the groom. Us being the bride and Yeshua being the groom. But then the fulfillment will come when he takes and touches your hand and you ascend. Now, you're married, like I'm married to my wife now. But then when Yeshua comes and marries you like he does here, he touched your hand. So you went from marrying your wife to a higher form of marriage with Yeshua. When he touched your hand, when you became immortal, when he changed you, you said you felt this light that comes around you as an immortal change. And resembles leaving the earthly marriage here with you and your wife, like me and my wife being married, and take it to a higher place with the Shamayim, the third heavens, where you're with your family now, walking along with everybody you love that made it to the Shamayim. Alright? And it's in a spiritual sense. Right now it's a spiritual sense. Our bodies have not been redeemed yet. So, I believe this is what your dream means. Alright? You get married to your girlfriend here, but there's another wedding coming for you, and that's the wedding of Yeshua. Yeshua says, good. This is what I made man and wife for. This is what I made man and woman for. To get married. To resemble my love with you. You guys resemble my love. You guys resemble my relationship with you. It's beautiful. And then when the time comes, he comes and gets both of you. And he says, now I'm going to marry the both of you. Now you belong to me. I will gather everybody to myself. That's what Yeshua says when he comes back. And then, take you to his Father's home. Alright? Because right now he's preparing that place. And I believe he's just about finished. If he's finished already, he's just waiting now for his Father to give him the go-ahead. Which, we are at the verge of that right now. If you go to the book, the Song of Solomon, it's chapter 2, verse 10, through 13. This is so cool because we just got off our Bible Prophecy Conference, and the whole theme of the Bible Prophecy Conference we did in Rockford was all about the wedding and the bride. And this is so great, and I wanted to save this video for that this time, this week, because I know we're kind of building up a lot of momentum from that conference. Look at it right here. Song of Solomon, chapter 2, verse 10 through 13. My beloved speaks and says to me, arise, my love, my beautiful one, and come away. Right there. It's talking about, it's a parallel to the resurrection of the dead at the catching away of the church. And then it goes on to say here, for behold, the winter is past and the rain is over and gone. The flowers appear on the earth. The time of singing has come, and the voice of the turtle dove is heard in our land. The fig tree ripens its figs, and the vines are in blossom. They give forth fragrance. Arise, my love, my beautiful one, and come away. Then again, it says it again. That is the catching away of those who are living at that time. They are taken up to the heavenlies for the gathering together. So it says, arise, my love, my beautiful one, come away. It says it once in verse 10, and then it goes to verse 13, where it says, arise, my love, my beautiful one, come away. You guys get it? 1 Thessalonians 4:16, 17, for the dead in Christ shall rise first, and then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up to meet them in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. That's a really, really cool parallel. I don't know if you guys have ever seen that before. We're running out of time, guys. Give your life to Jesus Christ. Repent for your sins. Ask Him to be your bridegroom. Ask Him into your life. His Spirit will come into you. So guys, get ready. Get married to Yeshua now. Accept Him as your Lord and Savior now. Get washed in His blood now, because we're running out of time. Okay? So Elohim, bless you. Hang in there. We're almost finished. Shalom.
Around October in 2009, I was reading the Bible and I wasn't dreaming. I was wide awake. I knew what was going on. Because I was reading the Bible and everything was seemed so normal. I wasn't in La La Land for sure. I read Matthew 24 where Jesus prophesies about the end time. So I was finishing reading verse 35 where it says, heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will never pass away. Then I proceeded to read the verse 36 that's supposed to say, but about that day and the hour, no one knows. Not even the angel in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. Instead of saying this, it says, 7 years from now. Then I thought, this is so odd, because in my estimation, it is supposed to say something like, that day and the hour no one knows, not even the Son, only the Father. For I remember that I have read this many times in the past. So I went back to the beginning of the verse 36 again. And it says, 7 years from now. So my inquiring mind was so curious, demanded to read it again for the third time. And again, it is saying the same thing, 7 years from now. At this point, I was thinking, this is so impossible that the Bible said this, because the book of the Matthew was written about 2,000 years ago. It cannot just say 7 years from, not just for me. So my mind again demanded to read again the verse 36. To my surprise, it was not in 7 years from now anymore. But it was written what it was supposed to be written, which was the day and the hour no one knows, not even Son, but only the Father. I know now the word came definitely spoke to me directly, because Jesus in John 6:63 said, "The word that I've spoken to you, they are spirit, and they are life." I believe that the Lord back then in 2009 wanted me to know the Lord will come in 7 years. Well, this is that year, because 2009 plus 7 equal 2016. I believe the Lord will come very soon.
One day, Jesus is coming. You may be at church. You may be at work. You may be asleep. God grant that you will be ready when He makes His personal appearance. My God, what if His appearance occurs on a Sunday morning? My prophetic word to you this morning is get ready! Get ready!
If Jehovah came back right now, would you make it?
Hell is a real place, and I don't want you to go there.
We've been reporting on the bizarre phenomenon that seems to be taking place not just in this country, but all over the world.
Getting angry at God isn't going to solve anything.
Don't butt dad me, young lady. I done said you can see that boy when we get to church.
This is not the way it's supposed to be.
Breaking news. There appears to be a rash of catastrophic incidents taking place across the state.
Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name have cast out devils? And in thy name done many wonderful works? And then Jesus said, I will profess unto them, I never knew you.
Esta ha sido una mañana muy espantosa de un catástrofe después del otro.
Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. So robes and positions and titles and classifications and auxiliaries and departments and works and paying your tithe and paying your dues will not save you.
We are still experiencing the aftershocks of the massive earthquake that have devastated this entire region.
But if you want to be raptured, you must be born again.
Citizen all over South Korea, we're here one moment and going to the next.
You must be washed in the blood of the Lamb.
I'm on my way to church.
What, Mama?
I just got off the phone with Mamie Cutler. She told me you the one got her granddaughter Jackie pregnant.
Pregnant?
Did I stutter? Pregnant, Bobby. What do you have to say for yourself?
Bobby, what's wrong with you, dude? Don't you know your mother loves you? She loves you. I love you. I'm your mentor. And you told me you would go to church today.
Brandon was looking forward to us going to church as a family again.
Dad, that I'm here?
No, baby. No.
Mommy loves you. I wouldn't trade you for anything in the world.
It's over! We've all been left behind!
It's gonna be joyful for those who are raptured, but it's gonna be sad for
for those who are left behind.
Life? Life as we know it!
You swore to me that you were going to get yourself together and start coming to church with me.
Not today, okay?
Midnight,
I'll meet you next time.
A loud cry rang out. The bridegroom came, and the door was shut. Can I see my wife and daughter separated from me in this endgame called Bible prophecy? Cause I won't bow down and worship the beast. The guillotine gon' have Christians out here, man, scared to speak. Never me, I'ma speak until my soul deceased. Cause I know one day my soul's gonna rise with the king. Till then he's bringing in his four horsemen. Disease, war, and famine to conquer the land. Open your eyes, realize, visualize. Accept Jesus Christ or get left behind. With the 666 barcode and beast mode, ready to lock, load, and take control. Now let's go. Seven seals, seven trumpets, seven bowls. Seven seals, seven trumpets, seven bowls. Seven seals, seven trumpets, seven bowls. Ready to lock, load, and take control. Three woes. Last days, end times. Accept Jesus Christ or get left behind. Once left behind, you can't press rewind. You see things that'll blow your mind. Last days, end times. Accept Jesus Christ or get left behind. Behind you can't press rewind. You see things that'll blow your mind. Visions of a darkened pit, real spit, locusts with human faces who came to torment. I'm saying to myself, if this is it, then this is it. Before I can throw up both of my hands, here comes the guillotine snake. She hiss in dark pits off his head, replaced it with a counterfeit. We thought you was bold and called yourself a soldier. Let's hear you scream out now to Almighty Jehovah. As I look into the sky and start to scream Elohim, everything that I seen was a dream from the guillotine. Locusts to human beings, Father God, it felt like a reality. Father God, why I felt like a casualty. He said, son, you better stay close to me. You living in the days of Bible prophecy. I'm only coming for a bride that's watching for me. Stay ready. Last days, end times. Accept Jesus Christ or get left behind. Once left behind, you can't press rewind. You see things that'll blow your mind. Last days, end times. Accept Jesus Christ or get left behind.
Most of people don't believe in Jesus as their savior. Majority of Christians love this world more than Jesus. Majority Christians still sin habitually. Jesus wants more people to go to heaven. But in reality, few people go to heaven. Jesus said in Matthew 7:13-14,
"Enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and there are many who go in by it. Because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way which leads to life, and there are few who find it."
Jesus said here in Matthew 7:14, there are few who find it. The reality is few people go to heaven and most people go to hell. What about people who get raptured or go to the wedding of the Lamb? In Isaiah 61:10,
"I will greatly rejoice in the Lord, my soul shall be joyful in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness. As a bridegroom decks himself with ornaments, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels."
In Isaiah 61, there are two clothes, those are the garments of salvation and the robe of righteousness. The garment of salvation is for the people who are saved. Once we repent our sins and believe in Jesus as our Savior, we will get it. We need that to go to heaven. This garment of salvation is considered the underwear. This is sufficient enough to go to heaven. But in order to go to wedding of the Lamb, we need the wedding clothes, which is the robe of righteousness. That's why the man was taken out of the wedding banquet in Matthew chapter 22. In Matthew 22:12,
he asked, "How did you get in here without wedding clothes, friend?" The man was speechless.
We need the wedding clothes in order to go to the wedding of the Lamb. The wedding clothes is the robe of righteousness. The robe of righteousness is for the people who live in holy and righteous life. Let's look at the book of Revelation to figure out what the robe of righteousness is. In Revelation 19:7-8,
"Let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife has made herself ready. and to her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright, for the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints.
Here in these verses, we need the fine linen which is the robe of righteousness for the marriage of the Lamb. It said it is the righteous acts of the saints. The garment of salvation is freely given whoever believe in Jesus. But we have to earn the robe of righteousness through our righteous act. Not many people wear this wedding clothes at this time. Pastor Hinsook Na saw only several people wore this robe out of thousands of people who were gathering for Christian meeting. After great earthquake and tsunami, there will be great revival before the rapture. At that time, so many people will repent their sins and will get this wedding clothes more. But do not wait for that time. I ask brothers and sisters to prepare right now. It is time to repent sincerely. It is time to surrender all to Jesus. I will introduce three servants of God who was talking about the percentage of people who will get raptured. Chu Thomas said that less than 10% of Christians will hear the trumpet sounds.
Our Lord has great concern for those Christians who will be left behind. He said the rapture will be like the twinkling of an eye, and very few Christians will hear the trumpet sound. Only those people who have Jesus in the center of their heart, and are ready and waiting for Him. The day He takes His chosen people out will be the greatest disaster this world could ever imagine. The Lord said that the Japan tsunami and earthquake was nothing compared what will happen to the world for those left behind. And in the end, most people will unfortunately receive the mark of the beast number 666. Many Christians will get it because they were never warned by their church. This is why the Lord is saying that less than 1% of pastors and less than 10% of Christians will hear the trumpet sound. I hope many pastors read about these messages. Please stay ready for the rapture, it could be at any time. Whatever it takes, let the Lord be the center of your life.
Why less than 1% of pastors? Many pastors preaching the prosperity gospel instead of true repentance and living holy life. God will ask the accountability to the pastors whose majority church members are left behind due to not proper preaching. Less than 10% means more than 90% of Christians will be left behind. This is a really serious issue. That's why Jesus was so concerned about it. Angelica Zambrano was shown similar vision. She said in her third video that 80% of evangelical Christians' church will be left behind. Watch this clip.
He said, this church has 20,000 members. There is another church with 10,000 members. This other church has 1,000. He continued to show me so many congregations. But there are very few people in these churches that are actually the true church. He asked me, are you seeing? Yes, I answered. The angel said, I must tell you what my Father wants me to tell you. The Archangel Michael was the one speaking to me. Michael told me again, look at the earth. The churches are filled with sin. There is very much sin in these churches. Many of the people are spiritually dead. Through the angels, the Lord showed me that 80% of the evangelical Christian church on earth will be left behind. They will be left behind because they are cold, because they don't see God's presence, because of their sin, because they are discouraged. Only 20% will be caught up to be with Jesus. This is only for true Christians. That is why His word says, many are called, but few are chosen. We are all called, but we not only must be called, we must also be chosen. Inside church, brothers and sisters happily praise the Lord. They rejoice, they dance, and they speak in tongues. But when they get home, they are completely different. They act like the devil himself. This is what takes place. People go home and speak things that hurt God's heart. At home, you don't pray, read God's word, or seek His presence. God does not want any of us to be left behind. It hurts me. that 80% of churchgoers are not ready for the Lord's return. Do you know why? Because few of the churches truly demonstrate the true love of Jesus. There were angels around when Jesus spoke to me. The angels were silent. The Lord said, "Daughter, my heart breaks to see how many people are discouraged, to see how many people have backslid. Tell my people to return to ancient paths, to their first love." Listen to what the Lord told me. He said, "Do you know which commandment my church has forgotten? Some think it's love, others think it's faith. The forgotten commandment within the church is holiness. My word says, 'Be holy, for I am holy.' This is what the Lord said. We have to be holy, inside and outside. We must have a pure heart, a clean heart that is filled with His presence, a heart filled with His love, a heart filled with God."
She said in her third video that 80% of evangelical Christians' church will be left behind. That means only 20% of evangelical Christians or born-again Christians will get raptured. Roughly half of Christians are evangelical. So 20% evangelical Christians are almost 10% of Christians. L.V. Zapata said in his video a few years ago that 80% of people who are watching his video will be left behind. Please watch this clip.
This is exactly what the Lord told me is happening now. The problem with people right now is the Holy Spirit is all over the earth, but he's not walking with many other people that he was walking, because they can continue to sin. They just want to sin. And the Holy Spirit is holy. He's God, holy, God Almighty. And he cannot continue, you know. Okay, don't get the mark of the beast. Why? If you get the mark of the beast, the Lord will not forgive you. It's very sad, because one night the Lord takes me into the tribulation, and guess what do you think I seen? I seen pastors that I knew with the mark of the beast on their hands. Why? Because they couldn't work. They couldn't work. Pastors will not will be able to work in the tribulations. Will not be able to get a job without nobody. Nobody will be able to get a job without the mark of the beast. And these pastors, Jesus, they say, "Oh, just give it to me. The Lord will forgive me." No. 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 Pastor, with almost most of the congregation, him and like 80% of the church will stay in the tribulation, the Lord showed me. Because I kept on asking the Lord, "Lord, do you want me in this church? I know you led me to this church. Do you want me in this church?" And mom was going by, and the Lord says, "I want you to get out of that church and seek me in your house." And I'm like, "Lord, you know, you want me to stay home, Lord, and seek your home, Lord. I want you to stay home and seek me in your house." Lord broke my heart the other night. I say broke my heart when he revealed to me that a lot of the people he's having me talk to them, I'm going to stay in the tribulation. A lot of the people that are watching my videos, Lord, how much percent? He's telling me 80% of the people will stay in the tribulation. Just imagine how sad that is. You know what he said to me? I've been telling them for years, over years, over years to prepare to get ready, but they have not listened to me.
So 80% of you who watching this video will be left behind. That means majority people who have been watching Rapture and End Time videos will be left behind. This is the reason that I made this video. You think that you will enter the marriage supper of the Lamb, but majority of you are not. That's why we need repentance. I was talking about this in the other video already for 3 days of repentance. It is time to repent sincerely. Jonah was in the belly of the great fish for 3 days. Have you thought about what he had done for 3 days? He had fasted and prayed for those days. God put him in the belly of fish and made him repent for 3 days. If you feel like you are not ready for the wedding of the Lamb, or if still live in sin, or if you feel like you need to one step closer to God, pray and fast for 3 days. Pray to God for how to fast. God will guide you how to pray and fast. One thing I know is that we don't have enough time left. If you are in the situation of not fasting, at least pray for 3 days of repentance. Some people may need more than 3 days of repentance. Ask God to know how many days you need to repent more. Consider that you have the robe of righteousness now. You need it to keep in good condition. In Revelation 3, 4,
yet you have a few people in Sardis who have not soiled their clothes. They will walk with me, dressed in white, for they are worthy.
The wedding clothes, the robe of righteousness, can be dirty by our sins. That's why we have to repent right away whenever we sin. At least repent daily. Ask God what you have sinned, because sometimes, we don't know what we have done wrong. If you keep sin again and again, you may lose your robe of righteousness. Pastor Hinsook Na saw this in heaven. She was wondered why dirty clothes in heaven. She found out someone sinned, and his robe become dirty. When he had sinned 7 times, his robe was taken out of him by angel and put it in the heaven. That's why she saw in heaven the dirty robes. Emptied hangers mean saints on the earth took this robe already. The white robes in heaven is waiting for someone, and it will be given to her once she is ready. In Revelation 16, 15,
look, I come like a thief. Blessed is the one who stays awake and remains clothed, so as not to go naked and be shamefully exposed.
We need this wedding clothes. And we have to keep it in good condition. Sins make it dirty. That's why we have to hate sins and love righteousness. Try not to sin as much as possible. Jesus talked to True Thomas that only pure and obedient Christians will go to rapture. In Ephesians 5, 27,
and to present her to himself as a radiant church, without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless.
Can you be without a spot or wrinkle or any other blemish but be holy and without fault? It is hard to do it by yourself. But once you pursue it, the Holy Spirit make you to be ready. God will make you a glorious bride. Forgive others unconditionally. Pray without ceasing. Be grateful in any circumstance. Love Jesus with all your heart. Be filled by the Holy Spirit. I pray all of you who watching this video will be ready as holy brides of Jesus.